Ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, WrestleZone would like to welcome you to tonight's live event. Before we begin, please be advised that all WrestleZone stars are professionally trained, so please do not copy or imitate anything you see here tonight. Please also be aware that WrestleZone is proud to provide entertainment suitable for all ages, and we ask that you refrain from using any inappropriate language this evening.
Hello and welcome to the final WrestleZone podcast for the year. I'm your host, as always, Billy. This is just a year in review, really. We're going to take a look at what's happened this year in WrestleZone in the Northeast promotion and maybe pick out some talking points, pick out some big stories that's happened over the course of 2023. I look ahead into 2024 as we've got Granite City Showdown coming in a few weeks on January 20th at the Rich Energy Arena in Aberdeen. Let's just dive into it, guys. It's been a great year for WrestleZone. 2022 was a phenomenal year for back-to-back sellouts, and 2023 was pretty much the same. A lot of sold-out shows in 2023 for WrestleZone. It all started with a little bit of shenanigans. So, coming into 2023, with new champions, new tag team champions, First City Saints defeated the Foundation of the Future at Christmas Chaos, and also Lost by Aspen became undisputed WrestleZone champion at that same event at Christmas Chaos. Mickey Vago retained the Tri-Counties Championship. So that's your Hall of Champions coming into 2023. So initially, Station Hotel Showdown was supposed to be on the 21st of January, but due to just events out with WrestleZone's control and out with the venue's control, it was moved to the 28th of January. I'll be perfectly honest, that worked fine for me because I couldn't attend on the 21st, but when they moved to the 28th, I got my ticket straight away. But I think that event sold out for a really, really solid lineup of matches. So we'll just go through the results of the show. So initially it was supposed to be a triple threat, Ronan King, Conor Malloy, and Chris Archer, but I think it was Captain Allen was supposed to be on that show. Unfortunately, he had to pull out, so it changed into the pre-show being Ronan King versus Chris Archer, which was a fantastic match, as you expect with these two guys. We've also got Kill Valhalla open the show, supposed to be taking on Captain Allen. This is going well already. Captain Allen, but they say he couldn't attend the event, couldn't face Kill Valhalla, so Conor Malloy went in his place, and I'll be honest, probably one of the best matches I've seen this year. Seen live, certainly, was Conor Malloy stepping up against Kale Valhalla. A match is available on YouTube as well, with and without commentary. I think WrestleZone on their own YouTube have it with commentary with Blue Thunder and James Chester. And you can go on without the commentary and just hear the crowd reaction. You can go to Kale Valhalla's YouTube channel and you'll be able to find the match there as well. But yeah, it was a phenomenal match. Absolutely incredible. 2-1 handicap match was next with the retiring of Scotty Swift at Christmas Chaos, thanks in part to Rhys Dawkins hitting him with a big book of Shakespeare. Saw Brian Tucker pin Scotty Swift at Christmas Chaos, seeing him retire, which was a very sad moment. It really took air out of Davidson Community Centre that night. It was a 2-1 handicap match. Brian Tucker, Rhys Dawkins defeated Omar Mohammed despite Omar's spirited display. He was there, all in there, trying to do all he could, but unfortunately the numbers became too much. And Talker, I've done that like three videos in a row now. Tucker and Dawkins were able to pick up the win on that night. In the WrestleZone Tag Team Titles match, Fair City Saints, Alex Webb and Stephen Miles had their first defense. Now this was supposed to be the outfit, Murphy and Dino. Unfortunately, Dino was unable to attend that event. I think it was due to injury or illness. So Ronan King stepped in for his second appearance of the evening to try and take away the WrestleZone Tag Team titles from the Fair City Saints. And a match that, again, was really close, a very, very close call. Murphy and Ronan seemed to strangely work very well together. They were able to work well, but not enough. And the Fair City Saints retained the titles. That moved on to the Tri-Counties title match. And here is the big story. First big news of the year was Zach Dynamite defeating Mickey Vago for the WrestleZone Tri-Counties Championship because of Chris Archer. So during the match, the Foundation got involved, as they always like to do. But Chris Archer arrived with a chain to try and ward off the Foundation. But struck Ricky Vago with that chain, which allowed Zach Dynamite to pick up the pin and pick up the title as well. So a big moment, a big oh my god moment, kicking off the year for WrestleZone, where we saw Chris Archer betray his rejected brethren by making and forcing Mickey Vigo to lose the Tri-County Championship with his intervention. Brad Evans defeated Tommy Raiden, dominated Tommy Raiden, I'll be perfectly honest when I'm reading that back. Brad Evans, steamrolled to Tommy Raiden, and in the main event, lost by Aspen, had his first undisputed WrestleZone title defense, where he was able to defeat Ryan Riley in a very strong main event. It was just two big lads leathering each other, which, fine by me, I'm happy with that. So a lot going on. The first event year at Station Hotel Showdown at the Station Hotel in Aberdeen, and that was the 28th of January. So we move on. So I want to just keep you in the know, keep you up to date, keep you going. So next up was Ellen. That was on the 18th of February at Victoria Hall in Ellen. So the pre-show, Dino defeated Tommy Raiden. We had Omar Mohammed defeat Captain Alan Sterling, who was able to return from overseas. Chris Archer defeating Blue Thunder in a rare appearance from Blue Thunder. Aspen defeated Murphy. Kyle Valhalla defeating Brad Evans in a big heavyweight contest. And a four-way, Conor Malloy defeating Rhys Dawkins, Ronan King, and Ryan Riley. And in the main event, Zach Dynamite was able to retain the title, the Tri-County title, against Mickey Vago, thanks again to a distraction from Chris Archer. Now, at this point, we really didn't have an explanation from Chris Archer, and from what I can remember, what I've seen, we didn't really ever get one, but we'll talk about that a little bit when we get to Aberdeen Anarchy. So that led us to the Regal Rumble, one of the best events of the year. Phenomenal events, which we'll love. I love the Regal Rumble. But before then, before we get to the Regal Rumble, the ComCon Scotland Northeast happened. That was 18th and 19th of March at P&J Live in Aberdeen. So a big arena, a lot of guests there, including wrestling legends like Hacksaw Jim Duggan. I think Booker T was that year as well. And Grado was also at that ComCon. I could be mixing it up with 2022. But a big opportunity, a big place to see WrestleZone in action. There was a lot of matches announced, a lot of matches happened as well. A lot of fun days. From the footage that I've seen of the event, a lot of new fans were made on that night, as well as we've seen the likes of Kirsten Louise, the photographer who goes to shows. This is when she discovered WrestleZone, and from that point onwards, immersed in the world of WrestleZone, as you see her photos through Facebook on Kirsten Louise Photography, also shared through WrestleZone and through the WrestleZone wrestlers as well. They share her action shots. So, Regal Rumble, Pearl Sports Complex. That was the 25th of March. A really nice venue. I really enjoy the Pearl Sports Complex as a venue itself. It's easy to get to, good parking, you know, all the logical grown-up stuff that I think about now as an adult when it comes to wrestling. Regal Rumble. In the pre-show, Conor Malloy defeated Murphy. We had the wrestling tag team titles opening the main show, which was an incredible match. Fair City Saints, Alex Webb, and Stephen Miles, they retained against the Foundation of the Future, Brad Evans and Ryan Riley. After this match, the first announcement for Aberdeen Anarchy was kind of announced, as the Foundation, Ryan Riley specifically, challenged Alex Webb and Stephen Miles to a 2 out of 3 falls match at Aberdeen Anarchy for the titles, because pointed out that the Saints had defeated the Foundation 2 matches in a row. So they wouldn't be able to do it 2 matches in one night. And that's how we got the 2 out of 3 falls match. It was accepted at the event. Mickey Vigo defeated Dino. Again, this was supposed to be Mickey Vigo versus Chris Archer, but Archer was unable to attend due to illness, which led to Dino subbing in for the match. So Mickey Vigo did get his hands on Archer that night. You have to wait a little bit longer for it. Damien defeated Ronan King, and we didn't mention, going back a bit, the Station Hotel. During the raffle, Damien, who was doing the raffle, he had an injury at Christmas Chaos, and he was doing the raffle with a hamstring injury. And Ronan King came out for his third appearance of the night to pretty much talk down to Damien. Told him that they would kind of put him out to pasture, he's too old, etc. Before finally kicking him his leg out of his leg and causing injury, exacerbation to that injury to Damien, which led us to the Regal Rumble, where they had a match. And it was supposed to be one-on-one match. That's what was announced. But Ronan King put out a 10-minute challenge to Damien, saying that he would have that Ronan could beat him within 10 minutes, and that was it, pretty much. That was kind of set up for it. So Damien held on for the 10 minutes. He was able to flim flam and fly and avoid that curb stomp, being able to outlast Damien, outlast Ronan for 10 minutes, which made Damien win the match. So, but we had Ronan, Damien really started to heat up during the start of the year on our road to Aberdeen Anarchy. We had Aspen, Cale Valhalla, and Omar Muhammad defeating Brian Tucker, Rhys Dawkins, and Zach Dynamite. And Dynamite left towards the end of the match because he was just done with Tucker and Dawkins. I'll say it slowly so I can say the names correctly. We also got to see Caleb and Shivani, which is always nice, always good to see. Which led us to the Regal Rumble match itself. 24-man Regal Rumble, supposed to be 25, but Chris Archer was unable to attend, which was finally down to the final four. Damien, Ryan Riley, Bruiser Brad Evans, and Caleb Valhalla. So thanks to Ronan King, who was eliminated very quickly by Damien. Damien had got distracted by Ronan King, which led to his own elimination as well. Caleb eliminated both members of the Foundation of the Future, the tag team version in WrestleZone anyway. I was able to eliminate Ryan Riley before finally eliminating Bruiser Brad Evans to win the Regal Rumble and book his place into the main event of Aberdeen Anarchy as Lost by Aspen entered the match afterwards, entered the ring as he was on commentary for the event to congratulate his opponent, his possible opponent, because, you know, there's still time between Regal Rumble and Aberdeen Anarchy, as possible opponent for the main event of Aberdeen Anarchy. An incredible first quarter of the year for WrestleZone. So between Regal Rumble and Aberdeen Anarchy, we did have an event at the Training Academy, which was in April 2023. And two shows, one day, afternoon show and evening show. That was the 22nd of April at the Wrestle Training Academy. A few matches took place. There was a couple wee points there that needs to be pointed out and picked up. So we'll start with the afternoon show, which is Mr. WrestleZone, Regal Rumble. I'm all over the place, as you can tell. I could re-record, but why would I do that? So back to the Regal Rumble itself for a brief moment. We saw debuts from Oliver Green. We also saw the debut of Mr. WrestleZone, the mysterious masked man who had been signed to a contract, but management had never known who Mr. WrestleZone was. Which Brian Tucker and Rhys Dawkins were determined was Scotty Swift making his return, because his triumphant return. We also saw Lord Mr. Malice die again because of Caleb Valhalla launching him from the top rope to the floor, but unfortunately there was nobody there and there's no pretty mats for him to be caught under. So unfortunately Lord Mr. Malice once again has passed away when it comes to WrestleZone at the very least. We also saw the debut of Deacon Matthews on the event, who tried to have a little bit of a duck and dive, a shuck and chive. And we've finally got to see a possible resolution between Caleb Valhalla and Captain Alan Sterling, as Deacon Matthews assisted Caleb to eliminate the captain from the Rumble itself. A man who, yeah, Deacon Matthews, very interesting individual who we get to know a little bit more in the future in WrestleZone. So back to the live Training Academy shows, we had Mr. WrestleZone defeating Rhys Dawkins in his official singles one-on-one debut, Chris Archer defeating Oliver Green. Now unfortunately this saw Chris Archer attack Oliver Green after the bout, with Mickey Vago making the save. Tommy Raiden defeated Murphy and upset, and Caleb Valhalla not on that show. I don't know why I said his name, got him on the brain. Captain Alan Sterling defeated Mickey Vago in the main event, which also led to Chris Archer putting out the challenge, or Vago putting out the challenge, and the match being set for Aberdeen Anarchy. We were going to get to see Mickey Vago and Chris Archer collide one-on-one. The evening show, Brad Evans defeated Alex Webb. Conor Malloy defeated Rhys Dawkins. Air Miles defeated Ryan Riley. So that's the Foundation and the Fair City Saints 1-1. Aspen Faith at the time. And Caleb Valhalla defeated Ronan King and Zach Dynamite. Forever the Foundation being defeated by the future Skull Brawl in the main event of the Live Training Academy show, evening edition as well. So that was it. We were on the road to Abu Dhabi. Matches were being announced left, right, and center, along with all those other debuts that I mentioned for the Regal Rumble. Ted O'Keefe made his return with the outfit after a little bit of a, seemed like a tense moment. They embraced, and the outfit were now a three-man group. He was announced to be in the pre-show match, taking on Oliver Green. And we've got Mickey Vago, Chris Archer, which became a mosh pit rules match, which means pretty much all music-related weapons were legal. We had Captain Allen, we'd have a was supposed to be taking on Deacon Matthews, but we'd have to have a mystery opponent on the night due to Deacon Matthews suffering an injury, which seems to unfortunately happen more shows this year, but WrestleZone have bounced back in every occasion. We had Damien versus Ronan King announced as well. There's a future title shot ladder match to be announced that had lots of competitors in it. We'll go through the results in a moment. This WrestleZone Omar Muhammad, where we team up against Brian Tucker and Rhys Dawkins, the Warriors against low life entities, definitely not Wally's. The Undisputed title was set, the main event, Aspen versus Caleb Valhalla as well. So going through that show, it was at Dayston Community Center on the 13th of May, an incredible night of wrestling at Dayston Community Center. It was just a phenomenal show, top to bottom. We had, so the pre-show, Ted O'Keefe defeated Oliver Green with a sharpshooter, throwing a submission move on his singles return. Mickey Vago defeated Chris Archer in the mosh pit, but this wasn't supposed to be the first match, according to new management representative Mr. Patterson, who made his return to WrestleZone after a six-month hiatus and now in a role of management, which I love to see Mr. P. He was going to be the judge, jury, and super executioner for WrestleZone going forward. And after a confrontation with Chris Archer, he announced, "You know what? Your match is first, mate. Your match is now, and he's going to embrace the chaos, going to bring the chaos. And he's going to see Mickey Vago come out, take on Chris Archer in a wild contest, which saw Vago pick up the win from over Chris Archer. Like I say, we never really found out why Chris Archer was so dead set against Mickey Vago. Like we're guessing, we're thinking some jealousy, because Vago has enjoyed such a great singles run since the return of shows in 2021. It could be the reason we never really find out. Captain Alan Starling defeated the returning Evan Young, who made his return after quite a while on the shelf or just away from shows in general. Evan came out with a captain's hat on because he's the captain now, but unfortunately he was unable to pick up the win after Captain Alan used the ropes to get a tainted victory. The WrestleZone Tag Team title match, the Foundation of the Future defeated Fair City Saints 2-1 to become the new WrestleZone Tag Team Champions. That's two championship reigns now for Foundation of the Future. And a match that started off quite respectful and ended with Bruiser Brad throwing Air Miles into a wall, which allowed Alex Webb to be just there for, was it there for the pickings? Is that the word? I can't remember the phrase off the top of my head. So he was able to be put down and unfortunately saw Foundation of the Future end their reign with the Tag Team Championships. In the Future Shot title match, so ladder match, bunch of folk in it. The winner gets a guaranteed title opportunity for the next year. I don't know if there was actually a time limit put onto it, but I'll say it's a year for the sake of me rambling on here. So Conor Malloy defeated Dino Murphy, Tommy Raiden, William Sterling, and Zach Dynamite in that match. So Zach didn't have to defend the Tri-Counties Championship, but he had the opportunity to get another title shot if he so wished as well. But it was down to Conor Malloy and Zach Dynamite. The outfit come close with Ted O'Keefe running at one point. I think William Sterling suffered an injury in that match as well. It was a wild, chaotic ladder match, but a fantastic match. And Conor Malloy was able to pick up the win. Damien versus Ronan King ended in a no contest, a very heated match, very awkward match, as we saw Damian get injured quite early on in the bout, which saw him just kind of surviving, trying to fight for some sort of survival. Somehow, though, it ended with a photo frame getting broken and Ronnie King jamming a piece of broken glass into the face of Damian, causing him to lose sight of one eye. So a very shocking end to a match. Damian and Ronnie King ending a no contest with mouth open, agape, oh my God, kind of reaction, that particular moment of WrestleZone. After that was Mr. WrestleZone and Omar Muhammad defeating Brian Tucker and Rhys Dawkins, something that was a little bit different. And we got to see Mr. WrestleZone throwing some shenanigans with his inability to use the ropes and finding an extra long tag rope, which then he got himself caught up into. And during the match, Rhys Dawkins got injured as well. So it's been a very topsy-turvy year for the wrestlers in WrestleZone when it comes to illness, injury, and missing shows. But like I say, the company is able to pivot and the wrestlers are able to hopefully be okay as well. So Omar Muhammad was able to get a satellite DDT onto Rhys Dawkins, and the team of Mr. WrestleZone, Omar Muhammad, successful on their first night as an actual team as well. In the main event, the WrestleZone Undisputed Championship, Aspen, Lost Boy Aspen, was able to retain against Caleb Valhalla. And this was just, again, another hard-hitting main event as two guys just laid into each other with everything they could, everything they could put into it. And before eventually Aspen was able to get the pin and able to defeat Caleb as the wrestlers came out after the match to help them both up for a handshake. A fantastic night for WrestleZone. An excellent night at Dayston Community Centre, which was rammed. It was absolutely rammed. It was everything was there. Meet and greets beforehand as well. And even then, we during the show, the ring broke slightly as well. While the bits under the cab, under the wooden slats, had to be repositioned as well. So it was a chaotic night for WrestleZone and an amazing match, amazing night for us as fans as well. So going forward, there was a big hiatus between main shows. That was 13th of May, and after that, we had to wait until the 5th of August for Battle of the Nations, which would take place at the Station Hotel. But that didn't stop WrestleZone. They had the Newborough Gala on the 27th of May, and they had Old Belgium Sports and Highland Games on the 17th of June. So you got to see WrestleZone if you're at galas over the season. You're able to still see some of your favourite WrestleZone stars as well. Led us to Battle of the Nations. We got the pre-show six-man tag team match. We had an absolute mugging when The Outfit, Dino and Murphy, and Ted O'Keefe as a unit defeated Air Miles, Oliver Green, and Tommy Raiden. And this was just the Outfit were just on fire. They ran through that trio on that given night at Battle of Nations at Station Hotel. In the opening match, WrestleZone tag team titles, The Foundation of the Future, Brad Evans and Ryan Riley defeated Bingo Balance, a returning Bingo Balance, and Connor Malloy. After the match, they called out all the tag teams and said that they just weren't good enough, and mentioning The Outfit by name, which led to The Outfit coming out and having a confrontation between The Outfit trio and the Foundation of the Future duo, which saw Evans and Riley walk away for the moment, for the time being. Captain Allen Starling defeated Deacon Matthews in a shenanigan-fueled match. We had a blindfold match. Damian defeated Ronan King, and despite Ronan briefly, and this is just rumour, briefly lifting up blindfold to get an unfair advantage, but Damian was able to hang on and get the win in that particular match. WrestleZone Tri-Counties Championship match, Caleb Valhalla bounced back, defeating Zach Dynamite for the WrestleZone Tri-Counties Championship, which was, again, not without controversy, as we saw The Outfit, or as we saw Foundation try to get involved initially, to, as they would like to do, try and help Zach Dynamite. However, the Outfit ran out to spark a brawl, with Dino Murphy, Bruiser Brad, and Ryan Riley all brawling at ringside. Ed O'Keefe ran out to take away the title belt that Zach Dynamite was trying to use to knock out Caleb Valhalla, which saw Caleb hit the spear and become the new WrestleZone Tri-Counties champion, his first title in WrestleZone. A phenomenal night for Caleb Valhalla. In a 2-1 handicap match, Brian Tucker was able to defeat the team of Mr. WrestleZone and Omar Muhammad. thanks in part to restocking's coming out and distracting Mr. WrestleZone long enough to allow Brian Tucker to take advantage. So looks like the team, the Warriors against Low Life Entities and Omar Muhammad and Mr. WrestleZone were locked in on a never-ending story. Then the main event, the WrestleZone Undisputed Championship, lost by Aspen, defeated Mickey Vago by pinfall in a match that was marred with controversy when Mickey Vago got his foot on the ropes during the match. And Mr. Patterson announced straight away that at the next big event, Halloween Hijinks, there'll be a rematch. Aspen will take on Mickey Vago once again for the Undisputed WrestleZone Championship. Poof. We're into September now. We're almost in September because I think we've got a couple of gala shows to point out that happened as well. So we had the 6th of August, the BrockCon in Fraserburgh. 19th of August, Lawrence Kirk Gala. And the 20th of August, Friends Duthie Park Open Day. So again, if there was a gala in the Northeast area, you're probably going to get to see WrestleZone at some point on those shows, weather dependent, of course. So into September, we've got Hopeville Social Club in Viruni on the hottest night of the year. Certainly felt like that as I sweated buckets during that event. It was just, the show was great, but my God, the weather was just so hot. I complain about that now when it's so cold out there, but oh my God, it was just an absolute sweatbox at Hopeville Social Club in Viruni. In the pre-show three-way, Conor Malloy defeated Oliver Green and Tommy Raiden. The very game triple threat. It was very great. It was great to see beforehand. This was pointed out that the three guys of the match were from outside of Aberdeen, and it was announced by Blue Thunder, who was doing the ring announcing for this particular match, as it was a great advertisement for the WrestleZone Training Academy. You should go find out more on social media. Ryan Riley defeated Murphy. So this is the first time we're seeing the outfit and Foundation of the Future starting to collide. These were one-on-one matches throughout the show. We're seeing these two teams really ramp it up. Brian Riley defeated Murphy. Dino defeated Brad Evans. Dino knocked Brad Evans out as well with his rolling forearm. A three-way match. Aspen defeated Damien and Reese Dawkins in a match that on paper was very random, but after Twitter conversations, Aspen was determined he was going to elbow drop Reese Dawkins' Book of Shakespeare. And by golly, he accomplished that goal. So we got that on that event. Ted O'Keefe and Zach Dynamite ended in a no contest after the Foundation, the outfit, all brawled. It was just chaos. We saw Kevin Security lose his glasses at one point. It was a very chaotic moment as everyone piled in to try and separate these six men from brawling any further, which would move on to Halloween Hijinks when we get to that. Mr. WrestleZone Omar Muhammad defeated the team of Captain Alan Sterling and Ronan King, which again, fun-filled shenanigans. At Battle of the Nations, it should be noted that, remember stuff as I go along here, that after the blindfold match between Damien and Ronan King, Captain Alan appeared on screen and determined that because Damien wore an eye patch, he was a pirate and needed to be eradicated from WrestleZone, which Damien didn't really seem to be amused by particularly. Or bemused, probably, was more the reaction. So after this tag team match, or during the conclusion of this tag team match, Damien did appear on the screen to accept the challenge for Halloween Hijinks from Captain Alan, which was enough for Alan to be distracted to see Mr. WrestleZone and Omar Muhammad take the advantage, pick up the win. Then the main event at Uvaruri was the WrestleZone Tri-Counties title match in the three-way. Captain Caleb. Caleb Valhalla defeated Brian Tucker and Mickey Vago in a spirited triple threat to retain the Tri-Counties Championship. So that's another main event for Vago when it comes to his tick box for the year. After all that, we've got two events left, so don't worry, there's still stuff to talk about. Halloween Hijinks. So initially, this event was supposed to take place on the 21st of October. But due to Storm Babette, the event was postponed to 2 weeks, to November 4th. Now, November 4th was supposed to be an event at Stonehaven, at Station Hotel in Stonehaven, and only one match was announced for that show at that point. So it was that show was just completely taken out of the calendar, and we got to return to Curl Aberdeen for Halloween hijinks. Unfortunately, an event I was unable to attend, so I could only really give you the results for the show and whatever was announced during the show itself and afterwards on socials. In a pre-show three-way, Oliver Green picked up his first win, defeating Chris Archer and Tommy Raiden. In a triple threat, the Halloween Brawl tag team match. So first time ever, two Halloween Brawls on the show as well. Mr. WrestleZone and Omar Muhammad defeated Brian Tucker and Rhys Dawkins. Conor Malloy defeated Alex Webb. This was supposed to be Conor Malloy versus Judas Grey, but Judas Grey was unable to attend the rescheduled date. So Alex Webb stepped in his place. The WrestleZone Tri-Counties title match, Ronan King defeated Caleb Valhalla by disqualification. But after Ronan King spat in the face of Caleb Valhalla, and Valhalla just went ballistic and went over the five count, which caused the DQ. Following the match, after the calm had taken place, Ronan then low-blowed Caleb Valhalla and stole the WrestleZone Tri-Counties Championship and was now within his possession. The tag team title match, the Foundation of the Future, it's written down as tag team title match. It wasn't a tag team title match. It was just a six-man showdown between the Foundation of the Future and the Outfit. Damn you, cage match, for having... I thought I'd be safe having you in my notes in front of me, but I've just read the verbatim like a Ron Burgundy. The Foundation of the Future, Brad Evans, Ryan Riley, Zach Dynamite, taking on the Outfit, Dino Murphy, and Ted O'Keefe, which saw the Outfit victorious in the match and were able to really score one off against the Foundation of the Future, which just further aggravated the team. The Halloween Switcheroo match, we had the Revolutionary Alan Sterling. yep, that all checks out. Defeating Captain Damien. And I said I didn't see the event, so I'm sure there were some sort of shenanigans. I'm absolutely positive of it. Then the main event, Halloween Brawl, with the Undisputed WrestleZone Championship, lost by Aspen, defeated Mickey Vago before being challenged by Conor Malloy, who was cashing in his future title opportunity for Christmas Chaos. So another wild night. I said I'm glad I didn't attend that. I was unable to attend that show, but it sounded like a wild night for WrestleZone. Last show. We've got one more show to talk about, and then we can all go and enjoy what's left of our leftovers, or whatever I put this out on whatever, on YouTube and Spotify, etc., etc. WrestleZone Christmas Chaos took place on the 2nd of December at Tainston Community Centre, so end of the year on a high, but in a very cold outdoor exterior. It was nice and warm inside Tainston Community Centre as well. In the pre-show, Oliver Green picked up his second win, defeating Chris Archer by pinfall. In the WrestleZone Tri-Counties title match that opened the main show, Caleb Valhalla was able to regain his title, as the possession of the title. He retained the title against Ronan King as well. Dino defeated Zach Dynamite. Dino was suffering from an injury coming into the match, a very interesting match for those that haven't seen our road trip episodes or what have you. It was a very, very intriguing match, which eventually saw Dino sneak a win just due to Zach Dynamite taking on all that injury and just targeting it throughout. In the Christmas Brawl, Damien defeated Captain Alan Sterling, had his Sea Santa with him. Santa Claus himself arrived to assist Damien towards the conclusion of the match. In the WrestleZone Tag Team title four-way, the Outfit, Murphy and Ted O'Keefe, defeated the Foundation of the Future, Brian Tucker and Rhys Dawkins, and Mr. WrestleZone and Omar Muhammad to become the new WrestleZone Tag Team Champions. It has been confirmed that they'll be operating under the Freebird rule once Dino returns to action following his post-match assault via Zach Dynamite. Mickey Vago defeated the debuting Judas Grey. In the interim, Mickey Vago had been given a ward by Mr. Patterson. He put Tommy Raiden into Mickey Vago's, I was going to say care, a bit charge. So Tommy Raiden was very integral to that match, whether Vago knows it or not, in defeating the debuting Judas Grey, who certainly left a big impression on the crowd at WrestleZone. Whether he likes it or not, the crowd really, they enjoyed him for him, but also disliked him because he was very, very dislikable on the night itself. But yeah, I hope we see Judas Grey more in the future in WrestleZone. He certainly will fit in. Before the main event, we saw Mr. WrestleZone assist with the raffle. It was supposed to be Mr. WrestleZone and Omar Muhammad, but Omar suffered a slight knee injury, so it was unable to, it was at a local medical facility. that was unable to help with the raffle. So we saw Mr. WrestleZone on his own doing the raffle with Mr. Patterson. The Foundation of the Future arrived, and after a brief skirmish, Mr. WrestleZone he said himself he wasn't stupid, he's going to leave. He's just going to leave now. But Zack Dynamite, he put that last dig in. He had to put that last dig in. He said that to paraphrase, there's footage online that Mr. Wrestle was a coward. Not something Scott Swift would do, etc., etc. I'll try and throw the footage somewhere here.
Because Scotty Swift would be such a godless coward. Whoa.
And that just set Scotty Swift off. My apologies, Mr. WrestleZone off. Mr. WrestleZone double legged to take down Zack Dynamite, but the numbers overwhelmed him. And we saw Mr. WrestleZone get pile driven, triple assisted pile driver from Foundation of the Future. His condition is yet to be confirmed. And in the main event, Conor Malloy was unable to defeat Lost by Aspen, so unable to become the WrestleZone Undisputed Champion. Aspen was able to get the win there. Again, another hard-fought match that people weren't taking Conor seriously. Aspen wasn't taking Conor seriously in this particular match either, and the odds were stacked against Conor Malloy, but unfortunately he's unable to eventually get the win. After the matches, it looked like that a handshake may take place. Ronan King arrived and attacked Lost Boy Aspen. And after a little brief moment, stare down between Conor and Ronan King, Conor pushed Ronan aside and started attacking Aspen as well, as we're seeing a new alliance form in WrestleZone. Only stopped because Kayla Valhalla came out as well to stop runoff Ronan and Conor, as we're now seeing the two young lads, the Flippy and Drippy team, the Aberdeen Dream team themselves, are now form in WrestleZone. So that was a big end to a big year in WrestleZone up in the Northeast, up here. And it just shows the consistency of the events the WrestleZone have put on, that I've just rattled through results. I mean, obviously haphazardly, because it wouldn't be a podcast I do without some sort of stumble and corrections being made in future events, going back in time and jumping about the timeline here. But as far as the year goes in WrestleZone, it's been just an absolute consistent year of shows. Sellout after sellout after sellout, big matches, big implications, and also big stories that we can look into the year, into 2024, as we move into Grand City Showdown at Rich Energy Arena in Aberdeen on January 20th. Tickets are available on ringsideworld.co.uk. So go find out now, or go into WrestleZone social media, WrestleZone Scotland, and you'll find all the ticket information. Go get a ticket, go to the show, maybe your first show of 2024, maybe your first wrestling show. Get on it, you'll enjoy it. Little bonus bit thrown in here. What I kind of missed during all that, during that review of the year, is I understated the Omar Muhammad, Mr. WrestleZone, Brian Tucker, Rhys Dawkins through line for the whole year. So, as I told you, at Christmas Chaos, Scotty Swift had to retire due to a loss to Brian Tucker, which was thanks to Rhys Dawkins. And they were having a budding team, Scotty Swift and Omar Muhammad. So that was very emotional. That moved on to the start of the year at Station Hotel Showdown. So I mentioned the results of that, I mentioned the handicap match, but during that match, Scotty Swift was in attendance at that show. So Scotty had gotten into it a little bit verbal with Brian Tucker. There was a little bit of a physical altercation, and Scotty got removed. Well, he didn't get removed from the building. He elected to leave the building after security separated Brian Tucker and Scotty Swift, because Scotty Swift's now a civilian, no longer a wrestler. So that's kind of where this all kicked off, and I've just slotted this in nicely somewhere in the episode, so I don't forget that. Other points in this kind of story was the lie detector test. You can go check it on YouTube. Lie detector test, Scotty Swift was brought in to prove that he isn't Mr. WrestleZone. There's a lot of investigative journalism from Brian Tucker, who convinced Rhys Dawkins of the same conclusion. This also led into events like the matches we've talked about, the handicap matches, the matches at Aberdeen Anarchy, The match is just all about Mr. WrestleZone, Omar Muhammad, and Dawkins Tucker. So yeah, we'll throw this in somewhere in the episode, just so I've made sure I've mentioned it, because it is quite an important story that happened throughout the year when it comes to WrestleZone. It seemed to have settled a little bit at Halloween hijinks, and Brian Tucker's looked to possibly move on from the investigation. However, the story looks like it's hotting up with the foundation of the future getting into the mind or rattling Mr. WrestleZone at Christmas Chaos. We'll see what 2024 brings when it comes to that. So yeah, extra bit. I'll use the ECW transition. Looks like we're getting Skull Brawl, the team of Lost by Aspen and Caleb Valhalla taking on Tony King and Conor Malloy. But as announced, has not been announced as yet. No matches have been announced for the event. So keep an eye on social media for that. We'll have a preview show. We're hoping to attend that show as well. Just have to see what the weather's like in the Northeast, because it can be a little bit icy, especially in January. Like January to March time, you never know what's going to happen. It's either going to be fantastic or it's going to be blistering heat. You just never know in Scotland. It will probably all happen in one day as well. So that's our year in WrestleZone. The podcast started round about the time of the Training Academy shows. What's this, number 11, like the episode number? I've enjoyed doing this. We've enjoyed speaking about WrestleZone to people who can listen, who will listen, who will watch, because it's just a passion project of mine. I enjoy the company, I enjoy the shows, and I wouldn't do it if I didn't. So it's been a great year for WrestleZone. I hope to expand the WrestleZone podcast into the future, into the new year. We did a pre-show with Blue Thunder, which then ultimately saw the show being rescheduled. That was the Halloween hijinks one. So I'm a little bit wary about bringing on co-hosts again, because it seems to be cursed. But we'll see what we can do for 2024. Hopefully we can bring some exclusive content for you, the listeners and the fans as well, of WrestleZone. So in the meantime, I have been Billy. This has been the year in review for WrestleZone. There's probably a million stories I've missed, and I apologize for that. So if you go check back our road trip episodes, our recaps, our reviews as well, we have lots of things in writing about WrestleZone to go check out on the website, swnscotland.com. I've been your host. I hope you have a great new year. If I've put this out before Christmas, Merry Christmas. If I haven't, hope your Christmas was really good. And yeah, have a good 2024, folks. See ya.